morning.
Good morning.
We greet you this morning in the name of Christ, this beautiful Lord's Day, a day to worship the Lord, a day which the Lord has made to rejoice, to be glad in it. And so we will rejoice, we will be glad. And I'm glad that you are here and that you are worshiping with us. We are also glad that you're joining us on live stream. And so we welcome you, and we are glad that we are able to worship with you in this capacity. And so we join together our hearts and our spirits as we join in worship. I think we got some word about Larissa and her baby. Did you want to share that? Someone
who... Marcus is here. She had a C-section on Friday. You can see the speech, and they are doing wonderful.
Good. And what's the baby? So, Larissa had
Marcus.
And Larissa and Marcus?
Marcus. The baby's name is Marcus.
Marcus, okay. Larissa and Alex had a wonderful baby, and everything went well, and so we are rejoicing in that.
And in the meantime, we are very, very fortunate to have with us, as our guest organist, Dr. Gail Kramer. Dr. Kramer received his bachelor's degree at Oberlin College and his master in music performance at Syracuse University and his doctorate in music arts and performance from the University of Michigan. Dr. Kramer was the organist at Metropolitan United Methodist Church for 30 years and is now retired living in Ann Arbor, but appears a great deal as much demand as a guest organist, and so we are very, very fortunate to have him playing for us today. So we welcome Dr. Kramer. We are so fortunate. I was thinking about how grateful I am to be able to stand before you and to be your pastor and about this church, and just thinking the way that you've been faithful and that you have been supportive and that you've been involved over this long period of pandemic, and when things are so out of kilter and not the way we're used to doing things, but you have been faithful. And so as we celebrate, we continue to celebrate Easter and the resurrection, we join together in worship. We welcome all of you who are here and who are joining us online. We begin our worship service with our call to worship.
Will you please join me in the call to worship? Answer us when we call, O God. Be gracious to us and hear our prayer.
When you are to judge us, be gracious for us. You put the balance in our hearts as though we find peace.
When we are disturbed, may we not sin, but ponder things on our beds and be silent.
I will hold thy hands to sleep in peace, for you will.
Please join now in the opening prayer.
O God, to chase the gloom of the disciples with the gospel of Easter and drown their desert of despair in the sea of grace, surprise us this day. Take from us the presumption that leans on your strength instead of ours. Assure us once again that our Lord's promise, keeping us always, still holds good. And be present with us now, as in the days of Jesus, to make us whole and to make us holy. Amen.
Please listen now as our chorus and Pastor Steve sing hymn number 306, The Strife is O'er, the Battle Done.
Thank you.
See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. Everyone who sins breaks the law. In fact, sin is lawlessness. But you know that he appeared so that we might take away our sins, and in him is no sin. No one who lives in him keeps on sinning. No one who continues to sin has either seen him or known him. Dear children, do not let anyone lead you astray. The one who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. Our second scripture reading comes to us from Luke 24, verses 36 through 48. While we were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled, and why do you doubt raise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. And repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. This is the word of God for the people of God."
Would you bow with me for just a word of prayer? Gracious God, we give thanks for your word. We give thanks for the inbreathing of the Holy Spirit that you gave to your disciples and that you give to us even to this day. So, Lord, we ask now for the power of your Holy Spirit to fall upon us and to infill us and enlighten the word, that the words of our mouth and the meditations of our hearts might be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. Well, our scripture reading in Luke sounds very familiar to the passage that we read last week in John. A very Luke's account of probably the same event. It was the evening after the resurrection, and so Jesus comes and appears to his disciples as they're locked away in the room that they were meeting. I was thinking about a story that one of our bishops actually told, and I can't remember which one it was, but one of our bishops told about how he really became a Christian and how he got involved in church, and he tells about how he ran with kind of a bunch of guys that were into mischief and things, they would break into the local United Methodist or the Methodist Church. They found a way to break into the basement door, and they would go in, and there was a pool table in there for the young people and things, and they'd shoot pool and they'd have fun and things, and then
sneak out, but one day the pastor caught them in the church, and the pastor, they thought, oh boy, we're really in trouble now, and he's going to really give it to us. And he said that this changed his life. The pastor wasn't angry at them. He said, you know, boys, instead of breaking in every night, why don't you just, and he gave them a key to the church. He gave them a key, and the bishop said, you know, for us it was like getting a key to the kingdom. It was like getting a key to the kingdom. And that's what he shared, what started him on his path to being a follower of Christ. I think that, you know, the church ought to be like I came across a story about Sunday school teachers. A Sunday school teacher who was asking her class about why they came to, what it was like coming to church, what it was like coming to Sunday school. And some of the kids, you know, made fun, and they came up with all kinds of stupid reasons why they came, and things that, you know, they're forced to come, or they got dragged here, and you know, a lot of us have stories about our drug addiction, that we were drugged to church, right, by our parents. But anyway, one little girl who was new, she didn't come from church. She hadn't been to church before. She wasn't dressed like some of the other kids and things, and she didn't say anything. But later on, after the class was over, she came to the Sunday school teacher and said, you know, I want to tell you what it's like for me to come to church. She said, it's like walking into the heart of God. It's like walking into the heart of God. It's, you know, church ought to be like walking into the heart of God. The church is anywhere two or three are gathered together, right? And the Spirit comes, and the risen Christ appears to the disciples as they're, in a sense, having church. They're fellowshipping. I love this passage in John's Gospel, or John's letter. Wonderful epistle. It's really not an epistle. Most scholars think that it's probably an extended sermon or a poetic sermon that's being delivered, and it's probably one of the last things written in our accepted Bible. It's probably written at the very end of the first century, probably around 90 AD, and the writer has a lot of connection to John, the Apostle John, the John that's mentioned over and over again in John's Gospel as the one who was Jesus' beloved disciple. And that writer begins this chapter 3 by saying, "See what great love the Father has lavished on us. See what great love." See. It's not just look, you know, and things. It's really look. It's not glance. It's not look. It just take a passing look, but it's really look. Peruse, survey, study. What love. The Greek word katopos expresses both quality and quantity. So much love. It's so indescribable how much God loves us. But it's not only how much He loves us, but it's the amazing love, agape love. It's like the old hymn, "See from His head, His hands, His feet, sorrow and love flow mingled down. Did there such love and sorrows meet, or thorns compose so rich a crown?"
does in the passage today, and in John's passage too. He speaks peace to his disciples to reassure, but then he does something physical. He does something concrete to allay their fears and to say, I'm not a ghost. I'm not a spirit, a disembodied spirit. He shows them his hands. He shows them his side. He shows them his feet. He shows them his wounds. He says, and then they were terrified. They thought he was a ghost. They thought he was a spirit. But he shows them his hands and his feet. Much like he showed Thomas, said to Thomas, put your hand in my side if you want to touch me and see that I am not a ghost. And then Jesus even confirms it even more by saying, you got something to eat? And they give him a piece of broiled fish to eat, and he eats it with them. He joins in meal fellowship. Isn't it interesting that almost in every instance with the risen Christ, there's some food involved? Sounds like good Methodist to me. There was always a meal going on. Well, last week we talked about how Jesus does not discard his humanness. He doesn't abandon, discard, or lose his scars. That the risen Christ continues to bear the marks of his humanity. He continues to bear the physical marks of his love for us. The resurrected Jesus bears the wounds of humanity. I love Sarah Rubin's new translation of the Gospels. She translates it this way, this passage. Look at my hands and my feet, and you'll know it's me in person. Feel me over and see, because a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you can see and observe that I have. It's the scars, Robert Barron commented in the lovely new, in this lovely new book, The Word on Fire Bible. A word woundless Christ is embraced much more readily by his executioners, since he doesn't remind them of their crime. So scars remind us of the forgiveness they need, the disciples, and the forgiveness that we all need, that he gives. Barron goes on to point out the plot of history and the world. Order destroyed through violence is restored through greater violence. We see this so much in Hollywood movies. You think of Rambo or Dirty Harry or any of those. Jesus undermines all of this. The scars remind he's not returning a greater violence for ours. Jesus is truly counterculture in his scars, in the way that he shows himself. I love the story that was recorded. I forget where I came across it, but it's a story of Greg Boyle, who is a Jesuit priest who has spent decades ministering in the toughest neighborhoods in Los Angeles. He's the founder of Homeboys Industries, which provides jobs and counseling to young men who have been released from prison. In an interview, Boyle told the story about Jose, a young man from the streets. When Jose was 6 years old, his mother told him to kill himself because no one wanted him. Can you imagine a mother saying that to their son? When he was 9, she abandoned him at an orphanage. His grandmother assumed custody of Jose, but she was cruel and beat him mercilessly to the point of having scars and wounds. It's no wonder that when Jose grew up, he turned to drugs and gangs and eventually crime and dealing with his painful past. Jose ended up in prison, which in some ways turned out to be a blessing for him, because there, through a prison ministry, he heard about Jesus. He responded to the message, became a follower of Christ, and then as Jose told Greg Boyle about his battle,
the scars left behind by his childhood beatings, his life on the streets, his drug use, his rough times. Since he found Jesus, Jose was no longer ashamed of his scars. As he said, "How could I help other wounded people if I did not make friends of my own wounds?" Jesus shows us his wounds. I think that's so remarkable that even the risen, exalted Jesus bears the scars, the marks of his humanity. Then I love the way this passage goes on. It says, we will be like him. We will be like him. We will. We don't know what we shall be, but we know that when we see him, we shall be like him. What we will be has not yet been revealed. It has been revealed, but not really, not fully. Clearly, resurrected life for us won't be a pleasant continuation of all we've done on earth, like golf with regular holes in one, or as Tammy Faye Baker used to say, heaven, she fantasized that heaven would be like a shopping mall where you have a credit card with no limit. And that's not what Jesus is presenting to his disciples and to us. There we will be like him. What was Jesus like? That's the ultimate humanity. Your truest self, what you'll be like. But then John adds, for we will see him as he is. I can't really elaborate on that sentence, any more than what John says. We don't know what we will be like, but we know that we'll be like him, for we will see him as he is. Think about it. If you see Jesus, if you really see Jesus, we become like him. We want to be like him. We see him as he is. Maybe the problem with too many Christians and too many churches is that we don't really see Jesus. We see a Jesus that we concocted in our own minds or that we've created out of our own making, but we don't see the Jesus of Scripture, the Jesus that appears to his disciples. The Jesus that shows infinite love, infinite mercy, infinite grace. Do we really love the world? Do we really love others? Do we really love our enemies like Jesus? The goal is to see Jesus. Be like him. I love the passage in Luke's account where Jesus opened their minds. It's probably very similar to what John recorded when he said that Jesus breathed on his disciples. He opened their mind and then taught them from the scriptures to help them understand. Well, wouldn't that be an interesting, terrific Bible study to have Jesus be the teacher? So he taught them, he opened their minds. He goes on to tell them, you are witnesses. You will be witnesses of me, witnesses of the good news, this gospel of forgiveness and repentance. I think it's interesting that witness, the word that Luke uses here is a very special Greek word. Martus is the word, martus. It's the word that we get martyr from. So Jesus is calling his disciples and us to be martyrs, to be all consumed by this gospel, to become like Jesus, to be martyrs, witnesses. Jesus sends his disciples out into life to be life martyrs. We think of martyrs as those people who die for a cause, and yes, those are martyrs. Those are people that have given up their lives, their very lives. And even to this day, I don't want to minimize the fact that there are martyrs in our world, people that have given their last full measure of devotion to Jesus and to the gospel. There are places all around the world that are where Christians particularly are facing tremendous persecution. In North Korea, you can be killed instantly if you're found out that you're a Christian. That's the worst case scenario. Best case scenario is that you'll be sent to a concentration camp and a prison. It's estimated that there are 50 to 75,000 Christians in North Korea that are in prison for their faith. In China, if there's even a hint that you are a Christian organization worshiping, if you're just getting together for meals, there will be cameras with face recognition installed everywhere so that they will know who you are. In Afghanistan, they practice mercy, or honor killings. If you become a Christian, you bring dishonor to the family. There are places around the world that are definitely places where people are martyrs in death, but Jesus is calling you and me to be living martyrs. I love the prayer of Saint Cyprian, who died around 258 AD. He lived during a time of tremendous persecution for the church. And this was his prayer. We believe and trust, Lord, that at a time of terrible persecution, you will hear and answer our prayers with the utmost urgency. We pray with all our hearts that you will give us courage to remain true to the gospel and proclaim your name right up till the moment of death. Then may we emerge from the snares of this world with our souls unscathed and rise from the darkness of this world into your glorious light. As we have been linked together by love and peace, and together we have endured persecution, may we rejoice together in the kingdom of heaven. St. Cyprian's prayer. Jesus empowers you and I with the power of the Holy Spirit. Like Paul says, that same power that was at work in Christ's resurrection, the same power that raised Christ from the dead, is at work within you, gives us power to be living witnesses, to really love the world, to really love others, to really take a stand in this world, a countercultural stand for Christ. I love what Debbie Thomas writes in her blog. She says these words, commenting on this scripture today. And so I need a Savior with a body like mine, a mind that adores, worships, and celebrates, but also a body that fails, ages, aches, breaks, and dies. A body that carries wounds and scars, visible and invisible, fresh and faded. A body that is profoundly and often terribly vulnerable to forces beyond my ability to mitigate or control. A body that is, for the most part, defenseless against injury, violence, illness, injustice, and cruelty. A body that might die, as Jesus himself died, too soon, out of season, away from loved ones, in random, inexplicable, cruelly traumatic circumstances too frightening to contemplate. I need a God who rescues bodies, a God who honors and even revels in physicality, who sees the danger and damage so often enacted against human flesh, and yet declares with absolute authority and credibility that our endings are and now are here and now are not the end. For me, the physical resurrection of Jesus is God's definite offering of both compassion and justice. All that has been taken, broken, mistreated, wronged, and forgotten will be restored. As many of you, and she's writing personally here. As many of you already know from reading my previous essays, I have two children who have spent the past many years struggling with physical and psychological illnesses. My prayers for their healing here now in this life will never stop. But for me, the resurrection of Jesus is the promise I cling to as a mother, the guarantee that even if my son spends the rest of his days on earth in debilitating pain, even if my daughter's anxiety and depression don't abate in this lifetime, there is hope for their healing. There is deep, vast, immeasurable, and indescribable hope. Eschatological hope. That means when God sets things to right in the future. Hope beyond hope. My children's story, the stories of their precious, divine, image-bearing, struggling bodies will not end here. As our epistle reading this week so eloquently puts it, beloved, we are God's children, here and now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this, when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. You are witnesses of these things. Again, I know that when we speak of resurrection, we are speaking about a profound mystery. Not for one moment do I claim to understand or to have a theological monopoly on interpreting the empty tomb. The only posture any of us can honestly assume in the face of such a remarkable story is a posture of humility. So I write only about what I have come to believe and love based on my own yearnings, hopes, and prayers. For me, the story of Easter is a story of embodiment through and through. It is a story of hands and feet, scars and hungers, skin and bone. Touch me and see is the invitation I live for, and somehow, against all odds, I believe. Reminded of the story of a little monk who lived toward the end of the 3rd century, probably died somewhere around 390 AD. This little monk, we don't even know what monastery he belonged to, probably was one of the early desert fathers, we're not sure. But this monk was named Telemachus, and Telemachus somehow got the notion, the feeling from God that he needed to go to Rome. So he packed up what little belongings he had in his knapsack, probably like a vagabond with a stick and his little satchel of meager belongings, and headed off to Rome. After traveling many, many months, he finally got to Rome. And as soon as he got to Rome, he was swept up in this crowd of people and moved along, and they were headed toward the Colosseum, and they were headed to the gladiatorial combats, the games. And so when Telemachus got there, he saw all that was going on. And by this time, Rome had made Christianity kind of the official religion, but there was still, it was still very pagan. And so as he's watching all of this go on, the gladiators killing each other, and animals, and all kinds of blood and gore and everything, he gets up and runs down onto the amphitheater floor and begins trying to separate the gladiators and shouting at them, saying, "Stop in the name of Christ, stop! And stop in the name of Christ, don't do this anymore, stop and stop." Finally, the people in the stand started to get frustrated and angry with him, and there's several stories, but the one that seems to be plausible is that finally one of the gladiators thrust their sword into his heart and killed him. With his dying breath, he's saying, "Please don't do this, stop, this is not what Christ wants, stop, in the name of Christ." We think that our actions, if we love like Christ, if we serve like Christ, if we take bold actions in the world against injustice and evil and
dying breath, he's saying, please stop this. Well, the emperor was Herodias, and Herodias was a Christian, at least a Christian in name, but he was so convicted by this little monk and this little monk's cry to not do this, to follow what Jesus, to be like Jesus, and to stop this horrendous killing and senseless violence. He was so moved by it, so convicted by it, that he stopped the gladiatorial combats, and there were no gladiatorial combats ever again. One person can make a difference. Jesus, the risen Christ, breathes on us, gives us the same power that raised Christ from the dead. He identifies with us in our suffering and our humanness. He joins with us and sends us out into the world to be witnesses, to be living martyrs for the cause of Christ. This wonderful message of repentance, which begins with our repentance, that we are sorry for all of the things that we have done, that we failed to do. This gospel of forgiveness, infinite mercy and love. Be a witness, a martyr for Christ. Bow to me for just a word of prayer. Gracious God, we give thanks for your word to us, and we give thanks for all your blessings. We give thanks for your love, your infinite love, your love that sent you all the way to the cross to bear the dreadful curse and scars for us, that you love the world and each one of us so much. Lord, we ask that you would help us to be followers of you, to be witnesses, to really see. That we would pray the prayer simply, Lord, I give you my life. Amen. Before our offering, just wanted to remind you that our mission emphasis, our monthly mission emphasis, is the Heifer Project, and also it's Native American Sunday, too, that we are thinking about and celebrating as well. And so we're going to watch just a little video of Heifer, the Heifer Project, and think about that and about generosity, the ways that you support Christ.
This is Alex Brown, Heifer International. And I used to have goats. Or maybe it wasn't goats. Maybe it was a cow, or a water buffalo, or a sheep, or a llama, or trees, or chickens, or even bees. In which case, leash would seem perhaps odd. Okay, my goats were not really missing. They went to a family, somewhere, to even here at home. They went to people who really needed it. Why a goat, you might ask, or a cow, or a water buffalo, or bees? Why not sit in tractors if you want to help? Well, first, because in most of the places in the world where heifer works, the nearest gas station is a very long way off. Gas probably costs $1,000 a liter. As for a mechanic, well, that's like in the next country. And let's face it, an animal has a much better engine, one that can move people's lives. You turn it on, it gives you milk, or wool, or eggs. It plows fields, it produces, how can I say this plainly, fertilizer that makes crops grow. It's like giving someone a small business, because all of those products, milk, wool, eggs, turn into income for medicine, school, clothing, a better home, a sustainable livelihood. And the animals produce livestock, because you know, animals make baby animals. That's what they do. Try that at a tractor sometime. Anyway, the next thing you know, the family is passing on the gift, sharing the animal's offspring and the training that came with it with another family who does the same thing, and so does the next family, and the next, until pretty soon, you've helped lift a whole community out of poverty. Cool, huh? Heifer International isn't just about animals and training. It's about the amazing things that happen when people realize they can stand strong all on their own. Like the resourcefulness and skills they discover, the communities they grow, the attitudes that change. It's amazing. Suddenly, hope.
those who may be dealing with the COVID virus. Pray that you would be with them and strengthen them. We pray, Lord, that you would bring an end to this surge, this pandemic that's so affected our lives and kill so many people around the world, Lord. We pray that you would be with those who are working in hospitals and frontline capacities, those who are administering the vaccines. Lord, we pray that you would be with them and that you would give them strength as they do this very important work. Lord, we pray that you would be with those who are grieving today. Lord, we lift up those from our own community of faith. Lord, we lift up those in our world, brothers and sisters who we may not know personally, but for whom our hearts also grieve. Lord, as we think of another mass shooting, we pray for those who have been killed and those who have those families that have been forever changed by these senseless acts. Lord, we pray that you would be with those who work for peace and those who work for, that seek to bring help to those who are troubled in their mind and their
Just a few announcements that call your attention. We're going to have a garage sale at the church, the house that that Good Shepherd has inherited, and so this yard sale, this garage sale, this estate sale, really, will be on April 23rd and 24th from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. And so if you'd like to come and look over and maybe find something that you really need, so you're invited to come. The house location is mentioned in here. It's 3633 Monroe Street near Carlisle. So that announcement, and then Bible study continues. We'll be starting a new Bible study this week, and so we invite you to join us on Zoom. And if you'd like to join the Bible study, just contact the church office and give us, make sure we have your email address so that we can send you the Zoom.
We could use help on Monday and Thursday. We could use help on Monday and Thursday
okay.
for prepping.
And Connie is reminding me that if you would like to help us get ready for the estate sale, we could use your help on Monday and Thursday afternoon. What time?
I don't know, afternoon.
Afternoon, maybe time. If you want to just stop by, there'll be somebody there working, getting things ready. So thank you. Those are the announcements that I have. Receive this blessing and benediction. Go out into the world. The risen Christ has opened.